Welcome to another Lightblade Learning Lab. Now the plan today was to jump onto the machine and do a benchmarking set of tests. Sadly, I realised that I was a tool short. And so we're going to have to make that tool. When I say I'm a tool short, I actually do have a tool for doing the job. But it's not a tool that you can use for doing the job. My tool requires me to have the lid open. And you won't be able to do that, but I think it's a sufficiently important piece of kit that I have redesigned it so that you can use it hands-free with the cover closed. I'm very politely calling it a beam health checker. That isn't what I really call it, and I will explain that when we get down to the machine. In the meantime, what we've got here on this page is two pieces of kit. We've got some acrylic 2mm thick, and we've got some card 200g, which is about half or 3/4 of a millimeter thick. If you don't have any 200g white card, cut the back off a cereal box and use the plain side of the cardboard. It will do the job just as well. First off, we're going to delete that bit because I always bring the whole of the job in on one DXF file, and then I just program them separately, because obviously we can't program card and acrylic on the same job. So we don't need the words acrylic on there. And just for your reference, the text that comes in here, you might not find text coming in on your DXF file. Well, if you go up here to config and look at file parameter setting, one of the things that's ticked up here on mine, which may not be ticked by default on yours, is import DX text information. Now it is quite important that maybe you have that set, because on a lot of the drawing files that I do add text information about where you can get things from. And it would be very convenient to probably see those on this screen if you have no other means of reading DXF files. Okay, that's just an aside. So we should delete the acrylic. And there we are, we're left with a clean file. Now, as I said to you, you're welcome to come up here and use the first technique with cut optimize handles. I don't go down that route, so I'm afraid you're going to have to follow me. So first of all, I'm going to capture all of the holes here. And then I'm going to pull down the shift key and capture all the holes just here. So that's all the holes. I'm going to put them into one group. Now the outsides are easy because all I'm going to do is go across the whole lot in that much, hold down the shift key and do the other bits and pieces. And there we go, that's all the outside captured group. Organise them. Two groups, dead easy, isn't it? So we just click on the holes and put them in a group, and then we'll put that lot there across in another group. Done. So that's most of the programming done. All we've got to do is double click on the black layer up here to open up the cutting parameters themselves. Now remember, this is 2mm acrylic. Speed for 2mm acrylic on this machine, I'm still not fully confident with it because I'm not familiar with all its capability at the moment, plus the fact that it's got a 2-inch lens in it, which I'm not used to. So I'm going to have to play safe. Speeds, I think I'm going to reduce that to something like maybe 15mm a second, just to play safe. And then we'll put the power up as high as I can, which if you remember on this machine is 67%. That's the maximum I can program into the machine. Okay, save that to a U file. Okay, now I'll finish with this file. I could either load the file in again, or a quick and simple way, a trick, is to press Control Z a few times carefully. 1, 2, 3, 4, and there we go. We've brought them all back into life. And this is the A4 card that we were using. And the only reason it's there is so that you can see how I've laid them out on a piece of A4 card. So we can delete that as well. Whoops. So we need to hold down the shift key, delete that bit, delete that bit. And there we go, we've cleaned it up. We don't need that. We delete that bit. And now we'll program this bit. Now this bit's easy because all we've got are these holes in here, which are not actually holes. These little things, they're going to be scorch marks. We don't want them to cut through. We want the outside shape to cut through, and again, if we look closely, the outside shape has not been completed. It's purposely been left with a little gap there so that these pieces stay tagged into the sheet. So we're going to mark these little circles to start with because they're targets. And because they're going to be scorched, they can't be on the same layer as the cuts because they're completely different cutting parameters. So we'll first of all go around and we'll collect all those little holes. Hold down the shift key and we'll keep the shift key held and we'll go down these one block at a time and we'll collect them. Okay, we've collected all the holes and we've collected none of the outside shapes. We're going to put those into a group, and now it looks as though we're going to have a lot of trouble collecting all of these outside shapes. No, we're not. All we do is this. We go across to the last but one, hold down the shift key, and then collect the last one. And there we go, all the shapes done in a group. And now we go and order them. Well, we've only got two items to order again. So we've got the scorch marks and we've got the outside shape. Okay. Now what we haven't done at the moment is put them on a different layer. But it's easy because now that we've put these into a group, we've only got to click on one of these holes, click. And we've collected all of the holes and we can pop them onto a blue layer, which we've now done. Technically, the blue layer should be above the black layer if it's going to cut first, but it's not going to worry us because we've specified how we want these things cut. So we'll just go and check what settings we've got for the blue layer. And the blue layer is a bit of an interesting one because, oh, it's okay, 200 millimeters a second. The problem I remember telling you this before, because we've got very small shapes here, the machine is never going to get to any maximum speed. So really what we put in here is immaterial, provided it's fast enough to keep the machine going as fast as it can go, because we want these marks to burn rather than cut. And then we need to put the power probably as low as we can possibly get it, just above where the machine will actually fire. And probably 10% might be it. It might be 8%, it might be 12%. We'll try 10% and see how it goes. Okay. So we'll save that to a file and we'll go out to the machine.
For these first few sessions, I'm going to keep repeating some of the stuff that I've already demonstrated just to try and hammer it home, because some of these things are very important. One of the most important is the autofocus. We've got some 2mm acrylic here. Check, is the head fully up? Okay, so we'll just make sure that the probe is over the workpiece and that head is fully up, which it is. And now we can press our autofocus enter. And it doesn't want to get there. Wait till it's settled to its safe position, and then we can manually set the probe down onto the work and lift it up just a shade, down and up about half a mil. And there we go. And now we can press the autofocus button again. We've got the program loaded. Well, we need to first of all move this to the appropriate corner of the job, which will always be there. Move it away from that magnet support, because I think I've got enough material at the end there. I can press the origin point there. And now frame. And there we go, we're staying within the material. Right, now we have the extraction on, we're ready to go. that's cut quite cleanly. There's that watery substance that I was telling you about, the sticky substance that gets produced when you cut. Yeah, it's all on the back here as well, which is good that it's settled on the back of the product, because it means it's not settling in the filter system. This honeycomb bed has one great advantage for cutting card and paper, if you're not worried about marks on the back. And that is, in fact, the airflow that's passing through here has got like a suction effect, which flattens the paper out onto the table. Just press the origin again to reset the origin, and away we go. The machine is moving around very nicely. It's quiet, doesn't rattle and rock and roll. It's very smooth action. I think those cuts are still too thick. But that may well be because it's a 2-inch lens, and I'm always used to looking at a 1.5-inch lens line, which is very, very fine. Okay, now just for comparison, I've run the same program on my other machine with the 1.5-inch lens, and yeah, I know this has nothing to do with this particular job, but it's all part of the learning process. You can see that it's a much, much finer cut than we're currently getting with this particular lens. Now, I don't know whether this thick cut is because of the lens, which I know will have a different cut width, but I didn't think it would probably be quite as big a difference as this. We shall find out when we do a little bit more investigation work further into the series. Now, because it's nice and convenient and light, I'm going to be using the machine as a workbench now. This is a little workshop. Now, these are the pieces that we've just cut, and I'm going to make them up into a very simple little assembly. We've got long pieces and we've got short pieces. We want the four long pieces to start with. We should find these with like two slots pointing up away from these tongues. Drop those into that square first, like that. Stand them up in the square. We should find the other ones, which have got slots along the bottom edge. And there we go. They will go together and make a little square assembly like that. And now that we've got them together, we're going to have to use some of our cement. We're going to just run the bead of cement along the bottom of each edge. And what we will do is turn it upside down, and we'll just apply pressure to the bottom of it for about half a minute. Okay, and having done that, we can put that aside. Now, the one that we want to work on is the one with the curved slots in it, and you'll find that there's two with slots that stick up in the air. So the slot ones with slots up go on opposite sides first, and then you'll find there the other remaining pair have got slots pointing downwards, and they cross lap into there like that to make another little box assembly. And we've got to do the same with that one. We're going to have to put some glue along the edges. And again, we'll try and turn that over, and we'll hold that upside down for another 30 seconds or so. We're missing one vital part. So, I'm sure that somewhere around your premises you will have, I'm sure you'll have, some elastic bands. Now, they don't need to be very big elastic bands, but I don't know what size I want. So I'm going to try the small ones to start with. They may or may not work. Oh yes, they will work. And look, we're going to thread two elastic band. We're going to thread an elastic band through that way. An elastic band through that way. And we've just made a little trampoline. Look, we're going to now add to the trampoline one of these little targets that you made. And we pop the target in there like that. And this last piece sits on top of the target. Like that. And I can hear you saying, what sort of worms are in that guy's brain? What the hell is that? I did promise you I'd tell you what all this was about when we got back to the machine. And I've now turned the machine on. And I'm just going to drop the table a little bit. Here I've got something which I've always affectionately called the Lacer World's answer to an anal thermometer. The only way you can tell it's an anal thermometer as opposed to an oral thermometer is probably the taste. This particular little piece of kit is the same sort of thing that your mum used to use when you said, oh, I've got a headache, mum. I've got a stomach ache, mum. I can't go to school today. And the first thing she'd do is get the thermometer out and she'd put it in your mouth and very quickly she'd say, it's nothing wrong with you, off you go. Well, this is the same sort of technique that I'm going to be using here. It's a very quick and dirty way of checking whether or not the machine is in ill health. Now, the normal use for this is you'd put a piece of masking tape on the back like that, and then at each corner of the machine, the back corner and in the middle of the machine, and I would just pop this into the middle of the machine. It doesn't matter where it is at the moment, to be honest, but you'd pop that into the middle of the machine. You would set the pulse power, in other words, the maximum power on the machine button, you'd set that to 15% so that it's fairly low power. The holes in here just neatly fit over and snuggle onto the end of the nozzle there so that the hole centers on the nozzle, and then you can just do beep, which is a pulse, and there we go. Look, you get a beautiful hole. And if you put that around the machine in five positions, you would expect to get, I mean, I've got a pattern, a perfect pattern there where all the holes are exactly the same, because obviously I've used it in the same position. But if you move it around the machine, those holes should be like that, all in the same position. If they're all out of position, it means your beam is totally incorrect. But the problem is, I can't ask you to do this because I need the cover open to hold it under the nozzle. But this is such a powerful test that I have reinvented this device to something that you can use for yourself. And it's this little trampoline. And what we're going to do, we're going to raise the table now so that there's about maybe an eighth of an inch overlap between this and the end of the nozzle. What I can then do is, this is the central position. Look, I can just pop that on there like that and it's held up against the nozzle. And now I can just go pulse. And if we look carefully at that, we can now see, it's not very central, is it? That's another interesting point. It's all over to one edge. That's what this piece of kit is, and we should be using that in the next session to find out just what the benchmarking data is for this machine. And we'll, if necessary, we'll give the machine a tune-up. So I think we're all now kitted out, ready to start. And the next session will be all about finding out just what we've got here.